So he took it upon himself to request the lady that was helping to convey him across the river. Her name was Satyavati. An incarnation of the Supreme Lord is to appear. I would like the service of being the father, would you be the mother? And she was pretty uncomfortable with all of that. Yeah. I know you're a great sage and all of that, but I'm not married. How can I become the mother of a child? I'm not married. And he gave different responses. He said, well, don't worry, you won't lose your virginity. This is a very special kind of an arrangement for the Supreme Lord. Well, yeah, but we're right in the middle of the river and everyone's going to see. And he said, don't worry, by my mystic power, I'll create an island that's invisible to others. And this is where this whole thing can happen. Yeah, but I'll be walking around pregnant for some period of time and I'm not married. So don't worry, he'll be born immediately. So she had trust and faith in Parashar Muni, and so she accepted. And Vyasadeva is an incarnation of Krishna. The verse is saying, he's an incarnation of Vasudeva. So Vasudeva, we know from Bhagavad Gita, means the son of Vasudeva. But it's also a position on the Chaturvyuha, Vasudeva Sankarshan Pradumna and Aniruddha, that he's the Supreme Lord, Vasudeva. And Vasudeva, the Supreme Lord, has expansions, and Vyasadeva is directly an expansion of Vasudeva in the spiritual world, appearing in this world as his direct incarnation. So in Vishnu Purana, Parashar Muni says, this Vyasadeva, he's the Supreme Lord. And I say that based upon this most wonderful Mahabharata that he prepared. This is Puranic information. He said in two yuga cycles ago, so Vyasadeva appeared in the 28th yuga cycle of Vaivasvata Manu. So in yuga cycle number 26, Parashar Muni, who was one of the Chiranjivas, he lives for a long time, he was also Vyas, meaning Vyas is a post. And someone, at the end of Dwarapa Yuga, because Kali Yuga is coming, the post is there and someone occupies the post and does this service of taking the Vedas, which are present in sound, and putting it in a written form. But this particular Vyas, according to Parashar Muni, Vishnu Purana, he's the personality of Godhead, because his presentation of Mahabharata is so fantastic. It's the best. It presents the conclusions of all the Vedas so nicely. He's the personality of Godhead. I mean, he knew it already because an incarnation of the Supreme Lord would come, and he became the father of that incarnation. Interestingly, when Vyasadeva was born, he was an adult. And he, with folded hands, came before his mother, Satyavati, and said, I have to go now. But if you ever need me for anything, just call my name. And immediately I'll come. So that message became useful later when Satyavati had to call Vyasadeva to become the father of the next king. Ambika and Ambalika. So, Vyasadeva is, all of that is Puranic. He's just simply, he's an incarnation of Vasudeva. Shukadeva Goswami knows that. He's not just a learned personality. is an incarnation of the personality of Godhead. Vishnu Tattva. Appearing for that purpose of presenting the entire Vedic wisdom. So he's offering respects to him. So whether it was an incarnation of Vasudeva or somebody that's a great personality that did that service, in either case, the student appropriately offers respect to the personality, to the teacher. So he's doing that. Similar to the previous verse, his prayer is that he'll properly transmit the knowledge and that the persons on the other side will be properly moved by that knowledge. Because why does a speaker like Shukadeva Goswami have an interest in doing anything? It's for the benefit of others. He's there. He was already at the stage of full Brahman realization after hearing Srimad Bhagavatam. He's now at Bhagavan realization in his fullness. He was at the stage of Prema Bhakti. Not, on the way. He is a perfected being. Even in that stage of being perfected being, he's praying to his spiritual master to be able to, Vyasadeva, to be effective in rendering the message. May it touch the hearts of others. That is to say, we're dependent. We discussed this yesterday. So now, continuing in that same mood, he's offering his respect to Vyasadeva in this very particular way, and in the poetic expression of Srimad Bhagavatam, it's choice poetry. That's how it's described, choice poetry. Choice, in the sense that it's para, it's transcendental. So the things that Vyasadeva said, it's transcendental. Like there was a question yesterday about different things that are within the Bhagavatam about demigods and so forth. Why is that there? Because how is that connected to Krishna? Because everything is connected with Krishna, including just the process of creation. You don't have creation without Krishna. Even if you have the elements, even if you're, like this friend who has his three PhDs and he can watch the cell of a frog divided from one to two. But it's not going to happen. Whatever the material laws that his research found, the material laws aren't going to operate. Matter isn't going to operate. The sanction of the demigods. Everything depends upon the touch of spirit. And that, who's going to measure that from the scientific community? They will never know. But one can know by this other process of descending knowledge. Not a perhaps, maybe, well, that sounds interesting and I have faith in that. But one can know as more soundly than one can know anything by empiric study. Like, I know the table exists. Knock, knock, there it is. I can see it, I can feel it. I can hear it when I... The symptom by sense perception is there. So that's pratyaksha. As real as one can see things by sense perception, one can see the soul, know the presence of the soul, that know this region of transcendence through transcendental sound. Pratyaksha avagamam dharmyam susukham kartavabhyam. This knowledge through the medium of devotional service is meant to give us direct perception of transcendence. Just like yesterday, we were hearing about the soul of Shishupal after Krishna very kindly removed the offensive part of his body from the rest. The soul, it's said in the Bhagavatam, the soul rose in the air like a comet and then descended within the body of Krishna, merged in the body of Krishna. Jiva Goswami commented, that one cannot see. It's a subtle point. One cannot see the soul. Well, how can they see something that you can't see? By arrangement of Krishna, one can see things that one can otherwise cannot see. One can see him, just like Shishupal saw Krishna, but he didn't see Krishna. He didn't see Krishna that we know. He saw, you know, a bad person. That means he didn't see Krishna. Satchitananda Vigraha Krishna, he didn't see. He saw something else. He saw something that's a manifestation, a mayic manifestation of Krishna. Just like Ravana stole Maya Sita, not Sita. A demon can't even touch the goddess of fortune. So what he stole was Maya Sita. So to be able to see Krishna, to be able to see, Jiva Goswami explains this. Although it's something you cannot see, they were able to see with transcendental vision. It's, you know, sounds a little tricky, but that's how transcendence works. It's a different set of laws than material laws. It's outside, beyond the jurisdiction of the laws that govern matter. It's another set of laws. Well, how do you know? That's a whole other, how do you know anything? How do you know the table exists? Well, I can see it, feel it, and hear it when I knock it. I know it exists. It's a whole discussion about what exists, because existence is not impermanent, it's permanent. Well, they go, okay, temporarily exists. But the senses are fallible. The instruments of gathering knowledge by senses and by reason are fallible. We know that. An honest person will know that. So we can't, I mean, what can we know that's infallible when the source of knowledge is infallible? That's the whole idea here. The source of the Vedas is infallible. And it comes from the mouth of Vyas. He spoke it to Shukadeva, and it was like nectar. Drops of nectar, through sound nectar, that fell into the ear of Shukadeva, and awakened his attraction for the wonderful pastimes of Ajita or Krishna. As the description comes in the 12th canto, when Shukadeva Goswami is wrapping up the whole Srimad Bhagavatam, or Sutta is describing what happened, how it happened that Shukadeva became Shukadeva, the great devotee speaker of the Bhagavatam. It was exactly what's here. He heard that nectar from the mouth of Vyas, which Sridhar Swami says, Jiva Goswami confirms, and then Prabhupada goes into this, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur takes it further, because Vyas is an expansion of Krishna, and Krishna also speaks nectar, transcendental sound, into the ears, or the hearts, of the residents of Vrindavan, and particularly the gopis. And then it gets, you know, really rasika and esoteric, and during rasa dance, Krishna shares nectar with the gopis that then enable them to do the rasa dance. The dance, the singing, the music, musical accompaniment along with the singing. I mean, that's really esoteric, very elevated. Now, we should not make the mistake of thinking that that's something mundane. It's really easy to think, uh-oh, we're getting into something mundane here. But it's not mundane because Krishna is not mundane. Krishna is para. There's a whole big difference. I mean, it's a world of difference between the material world and the spiritual world, of difference between things that are here and things that are there. Like, just yesterday, this discussion about when Shalva sent this mystical person that came as a messenger of Devaki, saying, oh, Shava has captured your father, Vasudeva, and he plans to kill him. And then the messenger goes and comes back with an apparition that looks like Vasudeva and cuts off the head of the apparition Vasudeva and then disappears with the head of Vasudeva to the ship of Shalva. And for a moment, Krishna becomes overcome for a moment, overcome with feelings of grief. So we know feelings of grief when there's some horrific loss, some trauma. That's different. That's the perverted reflection of the transcendental feeling that Krishna felt. So Vishnu says there can be feelings of grief caused by ignorance and feelings of grief caused by transcendence or knowledge. But Krishna is in full knowledge. He is Sat-Chit Ananda. Vigra, his form is Chit. So how can form that's Chit experience grief? Because it transcends grief. It's not like this one. Not due to ignorance. Not possible. So we have to understand, as Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur is very kindly helping in his commentary understand what Shukadeva Goswami is saying. Taking it even further, this nectar that comes from the mouth of Krishna, which then went to Vyasadeva, and then Vyasadeva gave that nectar to Shukadeva. The source is Krishna, the personality of God, and giving nectar to the gopis so that they can, through taking that nectar from Krishna, they can perform the transcendental rasa dance, the singing and music and dance. Really elevated. Vishwanath is such an acharya. He's definitely a rasika bhakta. On another platform altogether. And of course his interest is to help his reader properly understand the subtleties and the message of Srimad Bhagavatam. Like there was some discussion with somebody yesterday, whether it's a good idea to just go through and read the verses of Srimad Bhagavatam without the purports. And that way you get a gloss of the message of Srimad Bhagavatam. And without the purports, we're not going to understand the message. It's something. We're not going to understand the message of the Bhagavatam properly. That's why there's purports. So here, very mercifully, Srila Prabhupada, he didn't have to share this esoteric description of Vishwanath, but he does. It is to help us understand the transcendental nature of Krishna's activities in Vrindavan, and even specifically, Krishna's activities with the gopis. Krishna's imparting to the gopis their transcendental personalities in themselves, but they're also depending upon the contact with Krishna to do what they do. So Krishna gives the nectar, and they can have transcendental activity by his empowering them to do so. Krishna is the source of everything. I find it very interesting. This is the next to the last verse in the chapter called Process of Creation. Really high subject matter. Not an ordinary subject matter. And Shukadeva Goswami is appreciating what he's heard from Vyas, and what he has heard from Vyas in its ultimate stage is the personality of Godhead Krishna in the spiritual world of Goloka, and how Krishna exchanges with his devotees in the realm of Goloka. The exchange of nectar to enable them to perform transcendental activity with not a tinge of material contamination. Any discussion?
title of this chapter is process of creation.
Yes.
But if we read all these shlokas, Shukadeva Goswami has just offered prayers to the Lord.
It's a warm up.
What?
Because before speaking, one does these things and then, you know, he's going to speak. The cause of all causes. So, you know, from the absolute personality of Godhead, everything comes. And he's going to be speaking about creation, but so we should not make the mistake of thinking, oh, this is not so important, this is material. Whatever the Lord does is not material, it's from him who is fully transcendental. That's the proper way of the preamble before you speak on a subject matter is proper glorification. He's an expert speaker, he does it whole chapters worth. The beginning of the chapter is, the first three chapters of Canto 2 are a comprehensive response to the question asked by the Maharaj Pariksit in the last chapter, chapter 19 of Canto 1. There's two questions. What's the duty of the person who's about to die? What is that subject matter that one should always hear, chant, and remember? So, the three chapters. First step in God realization, Lord of the heart, and pure devotional service, change of heart. From, you know, forming a conception of God within nature up to the stage of the highest standard of prema bhakti. That's what one should do. And to achieve that, hear topics about Krishna. So he wants to hear topics about Krishna. The duty of a man who's about to die. Hear topics about Krishna to fix his mind in that way. So the first part of the chapter is describing the glories of Maharaj Pariksit. Then he starts asking about Krishna. But when he asks about Krishna, he doesn't say, can you tell me about rasa dance? He wants to hear about, I beg to know from you how the personality of Godhead, by his personal energies, creates these phenomenal universes. That's the entry point of hearing about transcendence, hearing about Krishna. It's not a mistake, you know, to understand Krishna's pastimes, these things must be properly understood. You have to understand what's around you before you can understand what's beyond what's around you. Otherwise, you're going to see what's beyond what's around you in a wrong term based on a wrong understanding of what's around you. The material atmosphere. You'll hear transcendence with a colored perspective, materially colored. So that's the question, and further exploring in detail that question. So before giving the detailed answer, there's several chapters of the detailed answer following. He's an ecstatic bhakta. He's just glorifying Krishna and the one who he's learned about Krishna from. Good afternoon, you always have a question. What's your question this morning?